on how we connect well. Yeah, that was
We are, for anybody viewing right now,
an application doesn't work either here.
But there's no one watching. Oh, right.
You can only go so far. Give people everything. You can ask for this.
We have a request. Hola.
Yeah, so also we recommend you.
Zero viewers.
Oh, that's, you're gonna let it run.
Yeah, you think people got the right link?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how to the mic.
Maybe just put another reminder up on Facebook.
Yeah,
well, please say that it's the talking starting to
grow. Oh, he's here.
He's here.
Hello, Omar.
The link is on Facebook. Just share the thing again. Up and then the people that don't want to watch. Maybe share it on your own personal page as well. Share the link. Let's say this is happening right now.
Yeah, but I don't even see what I have. Where is my...
Did you share it as Rosemar's four? Or did you share it as yourself? Do you see it on the page, Todd? Yeah, he sees it.
So we can see it.
Yeah, you can see it. Yeah, it's live streaming. Right, it's all that's happening right now.
Todd, can you put the hashtag down as well? So it's Ferguson 2 Marikana. No, Ferguson 2 Marikana. Really? Is it? Yeah, whatever. Marikana to Ferguson. Oh, does it? Okay, that's fine.
Can you see properly?
Yeah. Beautiful. Yeah, see.
How long is it? It's
just cherry.
Thank you.
Something when you want to start, I'll start recording. We have Andile. Andile. Apparently, we have two viewers now.
No, it's fine.
No, but apparently, there's two people watching.
Yeah. Yeah. Ready? Maybe that will multiply by 2,000.
Yeah. Just give me the charge one. Yeah, there's a 2 minute.
Thank you. We're here tonight for a talk entitled, I think it's Black Lives Matter. Maybe just to give an introduction to why or how we're having this event. It's basically in the wake of violence in Ferguson, in the United States, against our African-American brothers, or African brothers, some brothers and sisters, some identify, and Marikana coming up. Violence inflicted on our Black South African bodies, Black African bodies. And in attempting to connect these two struggles and two heritages of Black radical thoughts, we have invited leading scholar on Afro-pessimism, Dr. Omar, or leading thinker on Afro-pessimism, Dr. Omar Ricks, and Andile Mngxitama, who is the leading thinker on Black consciousness. Although I know some have debated and disputed that. not mentioning names. I think I'm just going to introduce each of our speakers at a little bit more length. Dr. Omar Ricks, as I mentioned, is a leading thinker on Afro-pessimist tradition, looking to engage with the Black radical tradition of thought and action. He has been published in several magazines and academic journals, but I think of those, the most prominent and I think interesting is the Feminist Wire, for which he is also the editorial staff. He wrote an article for TDR entitled Notes on the Blackout. And his dissertation in 2014 entitled On Jubilee was on the performance of Black leadership in the afterlife of slavery. He is also the owner of a co-op bakery. So Baker is also on his credentials. He's also engaged with a radical social center called Quilombo, which is derived from the Quilombo, whose name is derived from the Quilombo people of Brazil. And I think that's pretty much it. If you have any more queries on publications and thinking, you may speak to him after. Our second speaker, Andile, is, as I said, the leading Black consciousness thinker in South Africa. He was the political commissar for the EFF. He's the founder of the New Frank Talk. He has also written fiction, a book entitled The Fools of Melville. He has also written for City Press, Mail and Guardian, and also wrote an interesting, someone said to me earlier, shitty book called From a Place of Blackness. And he's also engaged with a new campaign called Black First, Land First. And again, if you have any more questions, you can engage with them afterwards. So each of our speakers will be speaking for 30 minutes. So Dr. Omar Ricks will begin, and then Andile will respond. And then I will open up the floor for questions. Also, just as a reminder, that this is a black space. So for those allies who are attending tonight, I would just like to remind you of that. And I reserve. I do reserve the right to kick you out if you become a problem. So I think we can begin with Dr. Omar.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for having me here, and thank you, Andile. Thank you. Thanks everybody for setting this up. The talk that I have, I give a title called The Problem of Black Lives Mattering. And usual kind of preface I give to it is some questions for people to keep in mind, which is about Afro-pessimism and the relationship between Black Lives Matter, Roads Must Fall, various movements that we have to take on in just being black, and what being black does to complicate that. And so the questions I have are, why is Afro-pessimism so important in a time when the police murder of black people is suddenly on people's minds in ways that it was not before? On the one hand, it is productive to think that this movement has come about that seems to focus on what I'm calling the ontological stakes of blackness. On the other hand, there is a risk inherent to all movements that articulated demands, including the falling of the statue of Cecil Rhodes, can be satisfied within the existing oppressive order. And so kind of how do we keep on pushing beyond that? Black consciousness and Afro-pessimism would seem to be important pieces, puzzle pieces in figuring out these, what I'm calling problematics of black leadership, things that we have to figure out as black leaders. And I kind of take the position that any of us can be leaders, right? Even though there may also need to be a vanguard at certain moments, right? But any of us can be leaders at any given moment in time. And the thing that keeps us leading, that makes us orient ourselves in a similar direction, so that we're leading the same struggle, going in the same similar directions, is what I think of as ethics. Ethics is the meaning given to leadership. Leadership is the performance of ethics, right? So how can one formulate a movement for one's own life and one's own concerns to matter? Can people whose lives do not matter form a movement to matter? How is Black Lives Matter as a movement even possible, right? So those are some of the basic questions I'm dealing with coming from the United States. I feel chilly, so I grab my favorite green canvas jacket from the trunk and return to the warmth of my car. Sorry, the trunk is the same as the boot. That's what we call a boot in the US, right? And I return to the warmth of my car in the parking lot of a minimum security prison. Through my rearview mirror, I am watching for the return of a family member from his work crew assignment. The pickup truck pulls up and drops off men who have been out working all day for the State Department of Transportation, or DOT. I notice that it follows a formula, and I can see that this is kind of by design. Green jackets, trousers, and boots obscure the individuality of these men, and they become values plugged into the formula in which the fixed positions of white masculinity and black nothingness play out. White man drives up in a DOT truck with a truckload full of blacks, wearing the same standard issue green jacket, similar to this one that I'm unwittingly wearing as I watch. White man in DOT watches blacks ring bell and then wait there shivering in the winter cold. White man in the heated DOT truck also waits 5, maybe 10 minutes while the other white man moseys up to the gate and waves confirmation that he's in charge of these blacks now. White man in DOT truck drives off to the lot behind the prison, and other white man pats down the blacks one at a time, making sure that the number who went out is the same as the number who came back. Another white man drives up in another DOT truck with blacks in the back. Repeat. Serena Williams is one of the most recent people to use the Twitter hashtag to comment on the police killing of black people in the United States. And she said, quote, I'm not sure if any of you caught this the other day, but she said, really? And a whole bunch of question marks and exclamation marks. Are we all sleeping on this and one giant, on this, and this is one gigantic bad nightmare? Hashtag Christian Taylor. How many hashtags now? Christian Taylor is the name of a young man who was recently killed by the police. He's a football player in the U.S. and I think after a game, he was drunk probably and was in the parking lot of a car dealership, hopping on top of the cars in the lot. Police officer pulls up and instead of doing what he might have done if it had been a white student, right, or a white person, he just started blasting. He just shut him down, right? Hashtag Christian Taylor. Our naming as black has long been bound up with our conversion into arithmetic. Yes, there's a mathematics of slaughter. That work has been done if it needed to be done. Every 28 hours in the United States, black women, men, and children are killed by police, security forces, and vigilante citizens acting with the protection of the law. Young black men are killed by police at a rate that is 21 times higher than that of young white men. And according to an updatable web resource by the London Guardian called The Counted, thus far in 2015, white people have been killed by police at the rate of 1.72 per million and black people at the rate of 4.4 per million. More than twice as many unarmed black people are killed by police as unarmed whites who were killed. Those are just some numbers. And when I got to the prison, I talked with my loved one for more than an hour. In the middle of our conversation about the meaning of something he was kind of becoming introduced to in the midst of the prison, Islam, a prison guard ducks his head in the door. White guy, pork chop, chubby. Looks around, looks at us, and counts. One. Two. And then he ducks back out. It takes me a moment to get what has just happened. From his perspective, he spotted a nigger in a green canvas jacket just like the one the inmates wore. He included me in the pre-dinner count of inmates. Now I have to get up and prove to him that I'm not his to count. But in order to do so, I will have to leave my loved one behind. Then I will have to approach this white man and reach into my pocket to get my wallet and ID. So what does it mean, this question, to matter? We say black lives matter. This question could be approached philosophically from any number of points, going back to ancient ideas about form versus substance. You know, and Judith Butler has a kind of sense of socio-politically constructed, sense of mattering through performative practices that sort of sediment over time and aren't necessarily ontological, but they have ontological effects. Ontology has to do with what it means to say that one exists, that one's existence matters. Historically, it's been located in the realm of metaphysics and theology because being was thought to come from God by many people. But as traditions of interpreting and understanding God or spiritual matters changed, philosophies of existentialism emerged. And I won't go into that bullshit, but this is what led This is what led Franz Fanon to say, ontology, leaving existence by the wayside, does not permit us to understand the being of the black. For not only must the black man be black, he must be black in the face of the white. Some will say that this has a correlate. In other words, that white people only gain their meaning in relation to blackness. He says this is false. The black man has no ontological resistance in the eyes of the white man, right? So if you're involved in something that converts you into a meaningless substance, let's say like a hashtag, right? The ways that our lives get reduced to hashtags. Hashtag Christian Taylor. Hashtag Renisha McBride. Hashtag Rahia Boyd. Hashtag Ayanna Stanley Jones, a seven-year-old child who was on her grandmother's couch when SWAT police officers came in, pursuing somebody else who lived in the house. As you know, sometimes poor people have to live with a number of people in the house. And they just proceeded to shoot. And they shot actually directly at the couch where Ayanna was sleeping. Killed her instantly. Hashtag. Right? So Serena Williams' comment about hashtags actually echoes long traditions of black thinking about what it means for our lives to matter and how accumulable or fungible we are, right? It echoes many comments that a lot of people have had about the accumulation of hashtags in places where black names used to be. And the notion that we are accumulable, that we are fungible, is in some ways itself all we need to know. In other words, the number signs of the statistics are very important. Every 28 hours, right, we're shot down by the people who are supposed to, quote, protect and serve, right? Those are important. But what's really fundamental, what is essential, as my professor Frank Wilderson would say, what is essential is that we are fungible. Black bodies are fungible. In some ways, that is really all we need to know. And if our lives are reduced to hashtags, stacked one on top of the other, like the numbers in a column used to talk about how many slaves jumped overboard on this trip across the Atlantic or the Indian Ocean, right? Like numbers in a column used to define those last moments of a person's life, where is there room for mattering, right? And many will say, well, the people who are on the deck of the slave ship, in other words, the people who manned those ships, the slave ships, they were themselves, you know, the subalterns. They weren't wealthy. They were just working white men, right? A person that is treated as though he doesn't matter is different in a fundamental way from one who is defined from the beginning of modernity as not really a person at all. There's a fundamental difference, and the only word that really comes to mind is the word that Fanon used, ontology. Ontology is the difference between the person walking on the deck of the slave ship and the person in the hold of the slave ship. The non-person in the hold of the slave ship. So a person that's treated as though he doesn't matter can always say, I'm being treated like a nigger. But what does the nigger say? A college degree, let me back up just a little. Someone who's not defined as really being a person is the opposite of mattering. In other words, mattering gains its meaning. Mattering matters in relation to the ones who don't matter, who have no matter, who have no substance, and who are thought of as being like black holes that suck matter into themselves, antimatter. Right? So things don't count as much once we're there. A college degree, people will walk around, you'll hear white people walking around saying, oh, college degrees don't matter as much anymore. What they really mean is that black people are getting too many college degrees. A college degree doesn't count as much if there's too many people looking like us who get it. A neighborhood is only a nice neighborhood to the extent that we're not there. Right? In fact, in the wake of the elections of Ronald Reagan in the 1980s, the election and re-election of Ronald Reagan in 1980, the Democratic Party in the United States, which is sort of the left-ish party, not really, it's left moderate, right? They're trying to figure out, wow, why are we losing so many people voting for the Republican, voting for Ronald Reagan, right? And so they went out and did polls, focus groups in places like Pennsylvania and Ohio and Michigan, places that are called the Rust Belt or the industrial kind of center of the United States used to be. This was working people's country, right? This was where the unions had the strongest stronghold, the highest percentage of the population that were unionized were in these states, right? And right around the 80s, even after Ronald Reagan proved himself to be the most anti-union president we've had, even though he's also the only president that the United States has ever had who was himself a member of a union, he was the president of the Screen Actors Guild, in case you know, you might not have known that, right, based on how he acted later on, right? But, you know, he's sitting there voting every time against unions. The first thing he does when he gets into office is he shuts down a strike of the air traffic controllers union, fires all of them. Thousands of air traffic controllers out of work because they were striking. And the white people in the United States who were working class, who were union, voted for him again in 1984, by a landslide. If you see the map of the United States, there's only one state that he didn't carry. That was the state of the other guy. Would have been pretty bad if that other guy had not even carried his own state, right? But when the Democratic Party polled people in, for example, places like Michigan, white people, asked them, why did you vote Republican? You're a Democrat, you're a union member. Why did you vote Republican? They said one thing. Black people. They thought that the Democratic Party was too closely aligned with black people. And anything aligned with black people automatically becomes anti-matter. It's the opposite of everything that you're striving to be as a citizen of modernity, as a fully recognized, quote unquote, human. A quote from one of the focus group interviews that the Democratic Party did. Not being black is what constitutes being middle class. Not living next to black people is what makes a neighborhood a decent place to live. I've memorized that quote because I teach a lot in classes, because it kind of crystallizes that sense of anti-matter, the opposite of matter. So if you don't matter, not only do your college degrees not matter, not only does my PhD not matter, what the fuck, right? Right? Neither does the things that I say hurt me. Like a statue of the leading genocider in all of Africa, right in the middle of the campus, right? Or a building in a high school, actually, in the state of Florida, or in the South, where I'm from in the United States, named Nathan Bedford Forrest High School, named after the founder of the Ku Klux Klan, who himself committed egregious atrocities against black soldiers during the U.S. Civil War. He was responsible for what's called the Fort Pillow Massacre of black soldiers. Black soldiers were surrounded. They were surrendering to his unit. He ordered all of them to be killed in complete violation of the rules of war, right? I'm talking about a buildings on campuses in the state of South Carolina, right near where I live, that are named after Pitchfork Ben Tillman, who was himself responsible for a massacre, of the Hamburg Massacre in South Carolina of black people, and used his pulpit as a governor of the state of South Carolina and later a senator of the United States to constantly promote lynching black people. Those are still in existence. And even more than those symbolic struggles are the plight of people who are in the schools themselves. Whereas as I was going through UC Berkeley, I came into UC Berkeley and I met three other black graduate students. Within a few years, two of them had left. One had had a nervous breakdown and had to go home. The other had committed suicide. So out of the four of us that used to hang out and kick it together, only two made it through, right? PhD program, UC Berkeley. Even on top of that, There's not having Black studies classes that let you address your study to the conditions of the people where you come from. If you don't matter, none of that stuff matters. But the way that you make it matter, the way that you make it matter is what we need to be focused on. You know, as was other slogan-based movements like Ain't I a Woman, or the civil rights movement, I Am a Man. We are not and have never been human subjects to this racist world order. If we were human subjects, that would be all that was needed for a protest movement like Black Lives Matter to work on its own. I'm not trying to cast no shade on Black Lives Matter. Black Lives Matter must continue its vital work, yet it must be backed up by force in reserve, by Black fighting formations, which are the matter, which are the things that make you matter, right? Unless a movement is to become only an appeal for those protected by the structure to incorporate us into it. Without Black fighting formations to enforce the mattering of Black lives, Black Lives Matter can only aspire to become white opinions matter. And if we are counting on the goodwill of our killers to incorporate us, the one number that we cannot count on is time.
Thank you, my sister, and also thanks to all the good people of the Roads Must Fall movement for inviting or allowing us into this space. And also, for me, I'm delighted for two reasons for Mari this evening. One is a few things I'm going to say about your movement, but also the presence of Brother Omar Ricks. Because the ideas of Afro-pessimism have energized some of us at a time when there was no possibility of a Black movement. And so you will see when I talk about you how, in some ways, you manifest these possibilities which at one point seemed not possible. It was like, we can do politics, but we can't do Black politics. And so I'm delighted that we, at this moment, able to talk in the same room. I want to say this very clearly, that the Roads Must Fall moment is the most important moment of post-1994 Black resistance. The most important moment, because it was able to pose the question. We have been fighting, I mean, some of us, since early 2000s, forming movements and so on, but the question was not posed. Posed in a manner that creates a crisis for the white supremacist project. This is the problem, that you can have service delivery protests and so on, and you can be busy, but you're not raising the question that creates a crisis for the white supremacist project. I think that you have done much better than most in being able to actually pose that question. And I think, as Frank says, I think he says, the real power is the power to pose the question. And so I think that you have done so. There are a number of conversations you must have, including understanding why the movement happens at the time that it happened. I'm thinking a little bit like a Leninist now. Okay, let's reiterate. The landscape of this city has been transformed. We have to always imagine this if we think about your struggle. You have removed the guy. There is no guy that's sitting there when you walk up to that university. So there is a reality of transforming the landscape as a result of your struggles. Of course, you will argue. Grow a piece written by black women. They ran a petition to silence a black woman and Kola put his name on that petition. No, it is a public thing. It's not the go to Politiken, check what is going there, and you'll see Kolela and our other brother Luke Gordon. They have their names there. So because you're a radical movement, you ask questions very directly. I think you must also must ask questions directly to our brother. Kolela, when you become this thing of full professor, how do we know you're not going to silence all of us? When you already started silencing people in that manner. So, okay, that matter is a thing that hurts me when I see. Let me just say one last thing on your movement, which I'm a groupie of. I really love this movement. No, I mean, and I have supported you from a distance for good reason. I'm controversial and so on and so forth. I have supported this movement. I've written not directly to your space outside to raise issues of how important the movement is, but I've not myself come into this space precisely because I think it's fine that you must discover all these things for yourself. So I take this, but Slavo Žižek, a white man, makes a point I think you must take seriously. And he says, and he was talking to the Occupy movement at its height. He said to them, don't fall too much in love with yourself. Because then you will not pose the question of what is the question today and what is the question the day after. So we are all happy, in love, we brought down this guy, and we no longer raise the questions, and we don't energize ourselves. Okay, that's enough about your movement. Let me say, and I'll just maybe summarize my own thoughts here, is that this question of posing a question is an old challenge for black people. And I think I always try to use the Eastern Cape, if you like, Xhosa speaking engagement with the colonial project, with the settler colonial project, where we have two responses as an oppressed people, as black people. The first is trying to make sense to the world. In other words, the world is a white world, and we try to make sense to the world. And it's a trap. And we can't win. We keep on trying to make sense of that world, and the world keep on throwing things at us. The second response is not trying to make sense to the world, it's to refuse the terms of the world. In the Eastern Cape engagement, if you think about it, it was that whole thing of Amakaba and Amagoboga, where Amagoboga are those of us who entered Western modernity. I call them the first real coconuts. The Xhosa English gentleman. I think Mbeki still symbolizes that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Now let me just say, the important thing about this is simply this. If you look at our resistance in the 19th century, and I'm running out of time, I think. If you look at the 19th century and how we responded to colonialism, the first, this Amagoboga response, this idea of trying to make sense to the world, it is what the ANC has done. This idea of actually we are all human, one, our demands for liberation is about one person, one vote, a constitution, rights, Siakuba, and so on. Let me just say that this idea of assimilation, actually, and some of us, African people, we accepted that somehow we're human, and the problem is that the settler is not allowing us into our common home. And so as a result of this, Umkhonto weSizwe, which was formed as a liberation movement by the African National Congress, was formed by white people, by the way. And you're absolutely, you must check your history. Look at Rufus' role in the formation of Umkhonto weSizwe and what she says about why it is needed. In fact, she argues that we need to have it because Polko, this is the Polko movement, is killing black people indiscriminately. So you have these guys from PAL, they come into the city, they're just killing white people. They're just killing white people. Whoever they see, they don't make the distinction between the police, the army, and the civilian. So we need, they say, we need an army which will have a program. And then they adopt Geneva Convention. Geneva Convention is a thing by white people in Europe that says in war you must only shoot in defense and leave alone the civilians. Now, in a settler situation where we are occupied, how do you make the distinction between a civilian and the army? Because you are under occupation by a settler colonial reality and population. Every single white person in that situation is part of the occupying force, and they behave as such, and they are all armed. So the ANC then, that's why the Umkhonto SA never got to shoot any white people.
I'm trying to talk about the one response after the Gomboka response.
So this is a misdiagnosis of the problem, and this misdiagnosis lead to incorporation instead of obliteration. And the 1955 Freedom Charter was, in my view, the clearest expression of surrender of the National Liberation Project. I mean, we can go into that. Let me just quickly now talk about Amakaba, what happens here. Because I think you come from the same tradition of Amakaba. What Roads Must Fall have done, in my view, is part of the tradition of Amakaba, because you pose the question in a way that does not allow for, shall we say, dialogue. Don't dialogue with the enemy. You break down the possibility of dialogue and you impose your version of what it means to be free. I argue that black consciousness and Pan-Africanism belongs also to that tradition, where, as we see today, I don't know if you know this, that members of the Azanian People's Liberation Army, APLA, are still in jail. Mm. Some of them for 26 years. They were arrested before 1994 for engaging in acts of liberation, which, of course, all of these acts had to do with harming white people. Oscar killed his girlfriend. He's coming out within a year. And they're releasing him this month. And they call it Women's Month also. But I think those are white people's things, right? But just think a little bit about the fact that for 20, the ANC has kept these liberation fighters in jail, in their jails. Because here's the thing, the Kaaba ethic does not make sense to this world of rights. Which, I mean, we can go on a little bit about these rights and so on. So I'll want to make one more point, then I'll shut up. I'll leave all this other stuff. Brother Omar, I was thinking that we need, before we leave here, say something about the Black August history that connects us to what happened in the 70s, because the killing of black people is not something that happened in the United States, of course, and everywhere else. In the 70s already, it was happening, and they murdered our brothers in jail. But these were fighting black people. George Jackson was a fighting brother. And his brother, Jonathan, did something amazing in 1970. He went into a jailhouse in the court with guns and his brother. He was 17, his other brothers. And because his brother, George, had been arrested with this crazy thing, indeterminate sentence of 1 to life sentence. You can spend 1 year, you can spend life. Yeah, this is the rights that are there in the US for black people. But this young, and then they charge this guy again for on false charges. Then 17-year-old Jonathan Jackson went to jail in a courtroom, guns, and liberated those brothers for a moment because they were shot and killed. But George Jackson, his older brother, when he writes about this, before he was murdered a year after, again on August, 1971. He says about his young brother, who's 17 years old, for a moment, he was free. When he took a gun and decided it's life for life, here, it is only at this moment when we enter into a conversation of equals with whiteness. Only at that moment that he had felt. So we must go back to what happened. Then they killed his brother, George, the following year. A whole movement, prison movement, started to radicalize our brothers in jail. And they studied radical literature. They fasted on this month in jail, all our brothers who would come to consciousness. And they disciplined themselves and went into deep ways of understanding the world to strengthen themselves so that they can build the revolutionary movement. That is the Black August moment, which I think is important as we rebuild to go back to energize ourselves. Now, of course, Marikana is simply the continuation of what has happened since 1652. A state which is anti-Black, white supremacist, violent against Black people has been taken over by Black people and is being continued. So the ANC, therefore, we can't talk about decolonization without talking about the ANC. This is posing the question of today. There are pseudo questions and there are real questions. A pseudo question is pay back the money. Nkandla. Because you end up sitting with the DA and the Afro Front and so on, all of them together, you want the guy to pay back the money. Well, if he does pay back the money, what happens next? This is not the real question. This is not a question that you have posed. It is not a question that brings crisis to the white supremacist reality. This is a question that normalizes white supremacy under the pretext of demanding accountability. Of course, the ANC is stealing a little bit, there's no doubt about that, and we must be unhappy about that. But when we reduce our struggle for liberation to this liberal demand, we are raising a pseudo question. Let me conclude by saying these two things. Anyone who talks about decolonization without talking about Fanon, as you say, and neocolonialism at the same time is also leading us to a pseudo question. In the South African context, colonialism is, of course, expression of white supremacy. Neocolonialism is the power, the political power in the state managed by the ANC. White supremacy in South Africa is kept together by the ANC rule because the ANC runs a state which has the monopoly over the use of violence. You are not going to get out of this reality. The ANC now, therefore, has become the bodyguard of whiteness. So we have a problem here. We want to go deal with whiteness, but here is the ANC standing here and blocking us with guns, and it will shoot us and kill us. So 1994 has created an additional problem for Black people, and that problem is called the ANC rule. I don't want to tell you about the statistics about death, which is in this country, for Black people, we don't count. By the way, brother, we don't even count. Every single year, 17,000 Black people are murdered in the ghetto. 17,000. Nobody give a fuck about that. Yeah. 17,000. That's. I mean, it varies between 14 to 17,000. That is a permanent state of war. Right? It's undeclared war. And that war we know is created by white supremacy and all the privileges, the comforts and security and wealth. This is the byproduct of this secured white life. But we have not created yet the language to make this a contradiction that help us to confront the real problem. But I'm saying to you now, the ANC has added a layer of a problem to our struggle. So we're going to have to remove the bodyguard first. Absolutely, because if I said to you now, black people tomorrow, today, let's go occupy land, who's going to call the police? Which police are going to shoot us? And we're going to end up in which jail? Run by whom? So let us be clear here, we have a problem. That problem is called immediately the ANC. And it's avoiding and avoiding or rather blocking us from dealing with the fundamental question of whiteness, because that's where we want to go. So those of us in land, in black face, land face are very clear. The land belongs to us, all of it.
Yeah. What?
And we're going to have to organize ourselves. Firstly to defeat the ANC is to expose it for what it is. I know you guys have avoided that because you want a pseudo unity amongst yourself. So I'm raising this issue very sharply because I think if we're gonna build a real movement that raises the fundamental question, also not being sidetracked by people who want to pay back the money to fight anti-ANC internal battles. Because that thing doesn't help us black people. So we must be clear about that, but we must be clear about also what the ANC represents. And it's not about Mosholozi. It is not who leads the ANC. The problem was not created by Zuma. Some people hate Zuma because he didn't go to UCT. This problem was created by Nelson Mandela and then given an intellectual veneer by Thabo Mbeki, and this guy is simply managing that project. But I think I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ricks. Thank you, Andile. I will now be opening up the floor for some questions. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to take four hands at a time. Try and keep it brief, please. Yeah. Okay. But most of the people know it's a man, so. But, okay. This is more than four. Okay, I'll take more than four. Okay, I'll start with Denai in the corner.
Thank you very much. So my question, not entirely related to what you're talking about, but it does roll up on that. How do we as Africans, or just South African context, still support a US movement, but still need to divorce ourselves from that struggle? Because it's interesting to find that here in Africa, being black, we want to piggyback right on the Black Lives Matter. And yes, it is a very important concept, a very important struggle that's happening in the US. But it doesn't necessarily deal to our actual issues that we have here. So sometimes we forget that our struggles are different. And black people in America have a different kind of supremacy that we have to deal with. So there's white supremacy, and there's also the American supremacy that we also have to deal with. So I'm just closing it out there to you. How do we still support and still separate those two spaces, understanding that they are two different struggles that do happen at the same time and are about black people, but they are different?
And then gentleman in the, it was the gentleman in the pink shirt. sorry. Mama Lema and the gentleman at the back in the saw. Four questions at a time, sorry.
My name is Clifford. I have a question. Since we are here as students, most of us, and some of us are just spending this day. Why this particular war, let's say, against white supremacy? There is a problem in terms of the system, because if we're saying we're going to be fighting the system, And if I was going to just go back into history, the only people that have been able to actually change the system, what is the old system, are the white people, and they did that through violence to change the existing system that was here for the African people. That is how they got to implement their own system. How do we, as this particular youth that is finding itself in this particular context, in this particular system, and surviving on the money system, which is also intertwined with the politics, and those politics lead back to white supremacy, pulling the very same strings that feed us and that actually school us in here to see. How do we dissociate ourselves or separate ourselves from the system to fight it at the same time, while still trying to live in that particular system without adopting liberal views, or without adopting maybe an ANC stance, which is a nationalistic or a political stance, as you would prefer to say. How do you deal with that? Let me just give an example. How do you, as a student, being funded by the very same system, stand up on television and speak against the very system that is actually feeding you and funding you? What happens to you, man? How do you move from there?
Our next question, Mama Nema. So if I can just ask you, when you ask questions, to stand up and try and raise your voice as much as possible. We are recording this.
My question is based on your Land First and Black First campaign. And you speak very well about how we have a certain group of black people that have become the vanguard, that call themselves a vanguard for the poor, that have become a vanguard for whiteness. Now, in our what we've tried to do is discard each other political badges, but clearly some people, like Clifford just mentioned now, that some people's political badges mean more to them than their blackness. So then now when we raise the clarion call for Land First, Black First, how then do we start? How do we view those certain security guards for whiteness, especially when it comes to an issue where all blacks must gain. How do we discipline them in that process? Because it can't be a matter of killing them. Because I mean, black lives have become worthless. Blacks just die like that. But now, how do you discipline them in order to ensure that they turn back into the right direction and they follow the mandate that said that is promoted?
Gentlemen at the back in the black leather.
My question is a bit shorter. Nowhere like the statue of Rose was taken off. Is there any idea of putting the statue of like black liberal, a leader of the black consciousness, in this place?
Okay, thank you. So that's our first round. I know most of you direct, so I guess Dr. Ricks, you can begin, and then Andile can also respond.
And Omar, please. Sorry, just call me Omar. Okay. So first to the sister who was asking about how you keep a movement going while here, while also divorcing it from the context of American supremacy. I think the important ideas of Pan-Africanism and the sort of ethic of Pan-Africanism is that the lines drawn between us are of as much importance as the lines drawn between slaves and the hold of a slave ship, right? The difference primarily between Africans here and Africans in the Americas is that your ancestors were, for whatever reason, spared from one particular boat, right? And mine were not, and that the fundamental divisions that we need to orient ourselves most towards are those between the people in the hold of the slave ship or the people potentially in the hold of the slave ship. and the people on the deck, right? So when we think about, you know, South Africa since 1652, or since, you know, in this this long modern era, the last 500 years, those are the, you know, that's the kind of long synchronic moment that we're still in, that manifests itself in different ways. This is not to say I want to ignore the ways that Black Americans receive a kind of performed privilege, you know, just by being affiliated with the United States of America. Like, I can travel here way more easily than any of you could travel to the United States, right? And that's something that seems to be very important. I will say that that's a dynamic that plays out in a lot of different ways. Affiliation with whiteness, or with a white space, with a predominantly white country, affords me, as a Black person, a certain amount of kind of, I don't even want to say privilege, because it's not my privilege. It's as much privilege as I have being in the deck of in the hold of a slave ship called America, right? And that boat just happens to be sailing in a particular way. And perhaps it happens to have a whole lot of guns on it, maybe more guns than the boat called South Africa has. But we're both in the hold of the slave ship. And I think, you know, I can't speak as much to the specifics of the struggle here, although I can say one of the things that Afro-pessimism kind of helps to clarify for me is that this long modernity that we are living in still is created by the intervention of one position into the context of the world before this era, and creating two new positions. The position that intervened is the position of the settler, which is also the position of the slave master. Sometimes they're wearing the hat called settler, sometimes they're wearing the hat called slave master, but they're the same people. Let's make no mistake about it. And the other positions that were created were the position of the indigenous person and the position of the slave. In the context of where I'm from, the United States, those are two separate positions. Native Americans were created as a group by their own genocide. They were created by their destruction, because they were not calling themselves Native Americans before white Europeans arrived and started slaughtering them all indiscriminately. Iroquois, Abenaki, Taino, all these different groups, Cherokee, right? Without discrimination. That's what created them as Native Americans, and said, it's less important for you to divide yourselves, Iroquois, from Apache. And it's more important for you to think of yourselves all as Native Americans. And by the same token, it created Black people, because we weren't calling ourselves Black before that moment. We were calling ourselves Xhosa and Zulu and Hausa and Fulani and Congo and all of these different groups. What creates us is a genocidal intervention that makes our lives not matter, that makes our lives the polar opposite of matter, right? And so those divisions between us, between Xhosa and, you know, Zulu, or between South African Black person and American Black person, important differences, right? I don't want to say that they're not important, but we have to begin to see them as being not essential, and to approaching these common problems that we face as ones of confronting a genocidal condition called blackness.
Okay, so I just want to emphasize on that point as well. The Black consciousness and the anti-colonial project in the African continent, if you think about it, its foundations are not in Africa, actually in the New World. The whole actual decolonization project does not start here. It starts from brothers and sisters in the New World. We use Black consciousness, which is a concept we take from the US. So I don't think we should put too much emphasis on the difference, because I struggle a lot to try to imagine what these actual differences are. And I'm very glad that, Brother Omar, you make the point of the slave master and the settler. That resolves immediately the problems that we have to seem to imagine ourselves recolonized by a certain colonial reality, and therefore we are not really in the same situation as black people in the US. I actually think the black people in the US are in a worse situation. They are a minority, let's start there. Here, we still have a chance if you think about it. Because we just have a problem of 10% of the population. So we our problem can be solved here. And when we solve it, our problem here is going to be resolved. Just like in Zimbabwe, they resolve their problem. Then I want to say something about the difficulty of trying to make a revolution. The question that brother raised there is an important one. But it has to be, we have to make a revolution. And it's good to develop an attitude that says, we'll take their money. You see, the big problem with Africans is that when we take their money, we don't do like other people do. We take their money and still fight them. Lenin did that. If you know how Lenin got this money to fight the Russian Revolution, he took money from people he knew were his structural enemies. He took their assistance. And he was absolutely clear about what it means to be free. White people have stolen from us. That bazaar belongs to you. It's a little bit of reparations. Right? Now, but we must also be sophisticated about this. Some must be in the front, must be known. We support them. Others are in the back. They take from the system to support these ones. We have to start thinking like this if we want to get out of the plantation. We must not expose ourselves unnecessarily. Right? It is a war. Guys, this is war. In war, you don't run around shouting, the enemy sees you and shoots you, right? You take cover. You accumulate your forces. When you are ready, you attack. When they accumulate on the other side, you retreat. This is how we have to understand this. And in my mind, I always think of us as trying to be part of a wave. You know, the wave comes and goes, and one day it's a tsunami. Think about it. This movement is important now. Your movement might not be important in another 2 years. But as a revolutionary, you're always plugging into the moment that brings about the crisis. We search for it, we look for it, we support it. Every moment of crisis is important for us. And our point is to make more crises for the system. So the brother is right to say that, how do we fight? You have to know, we're in battlefield here, we need the resources, but the biggest problem is that, and this is the failure of our revolutions, and even the party I come from. The sooner you get money, you eat it. Yeah. You know, let me tell you something. Somebody told the story about Bigo, and I mean, I'll stop. Someone told Steve Bigo that Bigo got money. People, you know that Bigo took money from the Oppenheimers. I hope you do, because he did. But yeah, he did. So here's the thing about it. The Oppenheimers had even bigger respect for Bigo because they gave money to everybody. But the only guy when they gave money to, you could see people are being released from jail, lawyers are being organized, and stuff is happening, is Bigo. Bigo gets the money today. Tomorrow, all this money has been distributed throughout the system of the party, of the movement. That's what you need. You need the discipline. You must not take the money and buy a Ferrari. Or what is that thing, a Porsche? This is the problem. We cannot allow this. And you know, I'm writing a book, by the way, about my experience, and I talk about this stuff as well. The thing, and I was very happy at one point when we, inside the movement I come from, we were being served. It was just a simple party, like a party where we got together, and we're served as leadership. Leadership was put in a VIP type situation in the township. So you sit there. But what I like is that after this, the same night, members of my movement who were not part of that VIP thing confronted us very, very hard. You separating yourself already. You are not in power. We're not then MPs. They did not know how soon that was going to change. But you already, live like this. So when you have power, it's going to happen. My brother, it's going to take us that discipline, but we know it can happen. Biko did it, Sobukwe did it, Sankara did it. So we must follow the good examples and we must call each other to account. This is the best way that we can build a revolutionary movement. And we need money. Anybody who says the revolution is going to happen without money is lying to you. We need the money. It might mean that we send you to rob a bank also. No. This is going to happen. My brother, how do we discipline the Askari? How do we discipline the Askaris? In Africa and also in the US, everywhere, you know, Malcolm X told us about the house Negro. Biko spoke about the non-white. The guy is black like me and you, but they stand in such a way in this battle that they actually get benefits from selling us out. Right? It's black people. Sometimes they say they do it because they must feed their families and so on and so forth. But the ANC doesn't have that excuse. The ANC is in power. Let's get this right. The ANC is in power. It runs the state. So this brother says, what are we going to do? The first thing is to convince all the black people who support the ANC to see for what it is. For me, it seems to me this is the first important job. No. That's fine. The system does not fit all of us. That's a nice thing about the system. It can only fit a few of us. And the majority of us are outside. So we have no business actually supporting the system. So my point is, the problem we have is a political imagination which is locked into the ANC. We're going to have to untangle ourselves from that. And how we do this, I think we need to get SASCO people who are here. Together with us, must go occupy land. And when the police come, they must go in the front because they must now negotiate with they must negotiate with the police that belong to their party. Do you realize I don't mention the DA at all? You know why I don't mention the DA? Because it's obviously white anti-black party. It is not even part of a conversation. So we're not going to raise it. But the ANC, we must crack the ANC. Our people have to be win over from the ANC. But here's the big part. We can't allow the recreation of many ANCs in this process. Like now you have the ANC, and then you have the militant ANC in red. You can't do that. We must stop the problem of the ANC to create a new movement, which is based on these ideas of land first. If you're a black person and you have a problem, you say black first. I want you to go home tonight and seriously think about it. Because it means that you have a problem and it's a deep problem. And we're a danger not to us only, to yourself as well. Because we're the only people on earth who have problems about being black and taking ourselves seriously as black people and putting ourselves first as well as black people. And I know there are black people here who have a problem with that, to say, yeah, let me leave it there. But I think my brother, this is the best way. We just have to call them what they are, their house Negroes, the Askaris, and we've always have black people who work like this. And you say we must not kill them, yes, but they kill us, remember. Marikana?
If killing is the best way,
No, but I take your point. Okay, I take your point.
So for the next round, there was a question at the back about the statue having a black consciousness. Person. I don't know if it should be answered.
I mean, I think just based on one of the things that Brother Andile was talking about, Brother George Jackson and Jonathan Jackson, I would say that'd be a great statue to have is a picture of Jonathan Jackson with his sawed-off shotgun taped around the neck of the judge as he was escorting him out of the. I would say you should push for that statue. Short of statues like that, I think one of the things that statues tend to do, unfortunately, is they tend to conservatize movements because they focus them on leaders. What we should be focusing on is building leadership. There's a distinction between leaders, which are you know mythic figures who can be connected to, who can be put on. I don't have any bills right now, but you know, you get the picture. I could pull out and show you a picture of one black leader who's being cathedralized. On the opposite side is a water buffalo, right? But that's the thing, is that we can be counted out like that, right? Even black leaders are slaves. Even black leaders are accumulable and fungible. In fact, in slavery in the United States, black people were counted as currency. We were counted as electoral value. It's written into the Constitution where we are three-fifths of a person for voting purposes. So that slave owners in the South, by buying more slaves, could buy themselves more representational power. So I'm getting a little bit far afield, but what I'm saying is that actually people who become leaders are just as fungible as any of the rest of us. And that when we focus our movements around them, we expose a particular weakness. Because there's no matter what black leader you've heard speak, there's always a little something that the structure can take and use from it. Right? You know, in the US we see this all the time with Martin Luther King. All the time. You got freaking corporations putting quotes from Martin Luther King's speeches on their commercials. Right? He was a radical motherfucking leader. Right? By the end of his life, he was becoming a radical poor people's campaign leader, and that's why they had to kill his ass. Right? That's why they had to kill him. But they still find a way, even though they killed him, they can still use him. Posthumously. So I think we should be very wary of the effort to commemorate particular leaders, except in those rare, rare moments, like the blowing off of the head of a judge in San Rafael, California in 1970, right? Or the slitting of a slave master's throat by Nat Turner, you know, or, you know, various moments, you can pick the moments, you know, if you want to create a statue, you can pick the moments, but make sure that they're things that it's going to take a real stretch for the structure to appropriate that discourse. You know?
So I've got my four hands for this round. So first come, first serve.
So my question is, in terms of taking the movement forward and if we make any strides, like immediate thing that's gonna happen is the Western world and all our ties in terms of economics is probably gonna end up either putting sanctions or doing something to the effect of cutting trade and that kind of thing. So my question is, in terms of taking the movement forward, I think it's probably important to be building ties with other African nations in terms of building relationships with trade and in trying to consolidate you know, that type of relationship. But like, I'm not quite sure about the possibilities and how that would happen. And the second thing I want to ask is regarding the almost like we're fighting a war on two sides because the Chinese are also coming into Africa now as becoming colonialism 2.0. And I feel like to the point where we get rid of whiteness, whatever that happens, we're going to be facing another type of problem in the East. And I want to know if there's any thoughts regarding that measure, because I think it's important to Africa.
Of course.
Hi, my name is Alicia. Actually, it's not a question, really. It's just a matter for engaging. The gentleman over there asked about what about, you know, black people who are silent in the past or they're acting in some kind of way. I just also sometimes feel like in the movement we have this tendency to cast ourselves as the field Negro, because a lot of us have been house Negroes, and like you were once house Negro, and what took you to get there, right? It was reading the right material and becoming conscious. And I think black solidarity is so important. I'm not saying like people need to be running around telling on like we need to accept that, but I'm just saying we must be careful of always casting ourselves as like we are in the house, guys. We are here. Yeah. we aren't the field Negro. And also remember that the house Negro can also like start a revolt from the inside.
Yes.
So don't be quick to cast yourself in that person. And then just on, you know, conscientizing the unconscious, it's such an important thing. And Stokely Carmichael actually has a really amazing video out on YouTube that maybe can be posted up on the RMM.
Well, it's about Christianity and to hear and hear black people are just so
Jesus.
Yeah, it stops them from actually becoming radical. Other issues also within black people, within our blackness. It's how do we deal with the differences? So some black people are more more wealthy than others. Then we have coloreds and Indians and black people who don't get along as well. Then we also have the LGBTIQA+ people who don't get along. We all have issues with some people who don't want to recognize them and things like that. So how do we do it for that?
Temba.
Sure, okay. I have like three questions. All right, let's start with the one of not existing, so black lives not mattering, because black people don't exist in the world, right? And I'm just going to make a few presuppositions and then pose my question, right? So you say black people don't really exist in the world, they're fungible. And the only way out of this whole morass is to end the world as we know it. So that we creating is then set up this paradigm, right, in which we live as like an ox, a donkey, a black, you know, we're just objects, correct? But in the same breath, that's sort of Afro-pessimistic view, in the same breath you say, and I'd like an answer from both Andile and from you, Omar, as well. You say that our souls are tied to the land, and you say land first. So you make an affirmation you make a premise, black first, I am black, an assertion. And then you go and say land first, but the presupposition is that I don't exist by saying I'm black. I don't exist in the world. But you then say land first, and if I get my land back, I'll step into being, ontologically sort of become, come into creation, come into being. And for me, it presents a serious paradigm. I'm putting it very simplistic, but just so we can sort of get to it very quickly. What's the answer on that? How do you explain this paradox, this paradigmatic versus the programmatic sort of problem? To help to others of God.
From Alex.
Anyone wants to add?
Yeah.
The one thing I would say, the Afro-pessimist, I'm also a Black Studies professor in the US and person who's been very involved. And to answer your question, I think it's a really simple answer. And Huey Newton was one of the people who, I think, answered it simply. We understand that we don't exist. And I believe we also understand that land doesn't necessarily make that so. But we have to be in a place of survival pending revolution, right? We have to be in a place where, okay, land is one place we start, but we do understand that we have to get rid of the world as we know, right? So for me, as I understand it, they don't contradict, right? Because right now we have no land, we don't have food, we don't have medical care, we don't have anything that we need to have in order to survive. And so therefore, it's going to take stuff like land. For you all, it might be land. For us, it might be something different that is several steps on the way to getting to where we need to get.
I'm sorry, you see, I don't want to get into another chair. Thank you so much. You see, this is, I think, precisely the problem, man. This is a nice balance. So we have Andile here, and you academics, you know, from the Black diaspora, so you can balance it out nicely. But
we're activists too.
So this is precisely my problem. I mean, I don't think, I think there comes the limitation, because we're saying that what we have over here, we can't create this ontological parity entirely. Because what we have over here, we have remnants. And Andile is particularly quiet on that, because Biko speaks about this in terms of history, in terms of bringing up Hinsa, and you know, the wars of the resistance. And so we have a particular history that is traceable, and it links us to some sort of, to a culture and to tradition and to some sort of being in the world. In your case, it's simply not there. There's no way of establishing that. It's ontologically flat. But in this case, in the South African context, we do have links to that, and we do have access to that knowledge. And hence, it's slightly different. We have a different recourse. When Andile says, our land is tied to our souls, you can't make that same claim in America. What is it tied to banking the money? Is it in Fort Knox? There's no tie, but here there's a direct tie. Our souls are tied to the land. I don't want the land simply because I want to farm. It is like my entire being is in the land. It's a spiritual thing. My being is in the land. I could give a fuck if I farm or whatever. It's more than a money thing. It's not a monetary thing. So now, again, please try and answer the question.
No, but I agree with you.
Can I just say one thing to that? But because we were kidnapped, we now are no longer dead?
No, look, I mean,
I think I permitted the dialogue to go on a bit too long. We can converse after it's done. Umbrellas from America. I think that we can. No, I don't like the hot topic.
Dialogue is good amongst us. I thought you guys were anarchists and so on. You know, you still want them to shout a little bit.
So I think. Okay. Sure. I think we've hit, obviously, I can see we've hit a hot topic. So I can see some hands in response directly to the land question. Gentlemen at the back.
I don't think there is a quite any consistency in that statement. The words called Tangofa, right?
Mm.
Okay. Looking back, going forward. So we must first know that when we're born, we don't thoughts out of just who we are. Everything, our whole perception is geared around seeing white. That's how we view the world. So our death or non-existence in the world is based on that view. We're not dead because we're black and we're confused. We're dead because of how the world of whiteness sees us. That makes us dead. Now, by us sitting here, we are beginning, or we are in the process of understanding that. And in the process of understanding that, we look back to who we are and time who we are as black people and our heritage and who we are in terms of the land. We are not free. We're still seeing things in this context. But looking back, we understand how we are. Now, when we conquer, we don't sit in this position and take land. That can never happen. We can't exist in whiteness with land. We can't take land and exist in the same society. So when we take land, it is a new view. If we're not here, we're there. We're like a bird that has journeyed now forward, but has continued to look back. So when we acknowledge our blackness, we take land, there's no contribution. There's no white perspective. White perspective is a myth. It's something that our ancestors are free. Because they now are liberated by our freedom. That is, I don't know if I'm making sense, but as I know it sounds weird, but as long as you're born and you look like this, you can only ever see this. If I say this is this, that's difficult. If I say that it's black, I can only say that it's black. But tomorrow when I wake up and I say that's white, who's going to tell me it's not white? It's white. That is the relevance of being black and land. It's no more the white perspective, it's a black perspective, it's culture. We don't go to old age homes, we don't send our grandkids to old age homes. Now we start to grow up. We don't send our kids to daycare. We understand that the community must grow up. It's a complete culture. So there's no contradiction. We must just achieve it.
I think it's a comment that I'm going to make. It's not a question because
on the land issue.
Yes. Maybe indirectly. I think most revolutionaries miss the point. And then I mean by this that this idea of which came first, the chicken or the egg? You know, it always goes back to that all the time. You know, and I feel and I see the gap everywhere. You have brothers, intellectuals who are interested on the ontological revolution, right? And then you have brothers who are interested in the bodily revolution. You know, this is like Umkai and Yinza, you know. But I don't see people combining all these forces together. You know, the African Americans, they have their own experience, right? But at the same time, we cannot deny their contribution into the black struggle, which we all suffer from, right? But at the same time, since we also attached to the land, it does mean that we should neglect that, you know? And forward to all these other nice books that are written elsewhere, like post-colonialists, all these post-colonialists do. But also, I think since we have a ground, we can combine all these other elements from outside, you know, in order for us to move forward. Otherwise, this is a waste of time, you know, we cannot be articulate about all these other ideas. I read Fanon, I read this, and da 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 da. But if we can't combine all these forces together, the matrix of whiteness will never defeat. We're always gonna be trophies of whiteness.
Now, no, I'm still here, I'm suffocating. But I understand at some point it's part of the revolution. You know, this concept of house negro and field negro, tempted to refer to you as a hustle negro. Because, you know, the last engagement that we had, if you recall in our campus, when you spoke of. I remember that from the perspective, I came back and voted and stated that the lack of an article referred to the likes of people as a coconut, referred to people as a hippie, referred to someone as a coconut, he said Kwame Nkrumah failed the machine and all that. I hope you remember that. And another problem I have is that you are still confusing the people. That's the most challenging thing that I have, is that you are confusing the people because you speak. Firstly, you spoke when you came here and campaigned, you spoke of the Thomas Sankara Oath, which you were selling a dream to Pan Africanists or one like us who believe in the Thomas Sankara Oath. But yet you came back again and you said, no, the Thomas Sankara Oath, which I asked what. When you guys in the red, you went out and bought food in the streets, trying to apply for economic encouragement, of course, was that just a public stance on a television show? And you said, yes, it was a television show. And again, asked about Khayelitsha, because you promised that if they won't start the Khayelitsha, because they use that hospital in Khayelitsha. I said, no, I don't use that hospital, it's against me, keep me back. So you have those sharp contradictions. So somehow you don't find a deep contradiction. You speak one time and you do the other. You know, and then you come back again. By the way, the politics of the school of land-based is politics that have been there. In the politics of Pan-Africanism, which in the PC as well, you preached a long time ago. And then you went to EFF, you spoke. The politics of land, which were politicized inside the politics, but when you go out and outside of EFF, you speak radical politics, but when the politics of EFF were romantic politics, which are not surprising now, you know. So there's this problem within you. I have this problem of you continuously confuse black people. Now you confuse black people all the time. Now, what I'm listening to is whether to listen to me, which Andile to listen to. Which Andile to listen to. The Andile who spoke of other religions, and we had an opportunity to implement Thomas Arapo. Then we did not even try to do anything about the Thomas Arapo. Now, to me, I'm not just a revolutionary by speaking. I live action, not revolution. You know, I believe in that. That's what I do. Because revolution to me is not a principle. It should be an institution. That's what the problem I have with even the likes of ANC, EFF, or any other common party, that we use revolution as a principle, Pan-Africanism as a principle, not necessarily as an institution. And that's basically the problem I have with you. You do a good presentation today, you speak of politics that are relevant to the likes of us. You say Pan-Africanism is even the second term now of leftless and leftless, but what changes the concept to how we have and sell this brain. But then when you're given an opportunity to speak of this thing. Now, what I'm struggling with on how you perceive and describe Prof. Kolaban is not different of how you contradicting yourself from people according to me. You know what?
Okay.
But
I'm sorry.
I want to impose the question. Okay. Let alone that. That is just a problem that I have. As much as I want to engage with you better, that's just a problem that I have. I have this problem with you. Being a contradicting yourself. But what I want to impose the question now is this one to this house and even on the outside from the gentleman in the front is that what happens when in a revolution, because as a revolutionary leader, as a constituent who leads people, and sometimes I ask these questions when these questions come, you know, what happens when the sharp contradictions within movements emerge, you know, you find the gender politics, you know, and the race politics, and the class politics, you know, which is something that has happened in the context of UCT, in the context of RMF, in the context of any movement that I've been joining. You know, you find those sharp contradictions emerging of gender politics, race politics, and class politics. However, class politics will always come last in black people, they will always come last. But they will talk of prioritizing, mostly they will use prioritize race politics. But obviously, our women will say, no, race politics have been prioritized, let's prioritize gender politics. And our brothers of Sweden will say, okay, we've been prioritizing race politics, let's prioritize gender politics. Some of the people of the working class say, no, but what about the working class? I don't feel like I'm going to represent that. People have been coming to me and say, no, I don't feel like those people represent me because I'm the working class. It's the person who speaks on the working class, you know. But some will come and say, no, but Hasmas doesn't speak on the gender class, on the gender. Politics. It speaks for the race politics, you know what I mean? So what happens when those sharp contradictions emerge? How do you deal with those contradictions, my fellow brothers? But I was just trying to explain the problem that I'm finding.
Okay, so Omar will start.
I want to start with the brother who was just speaking, and I want to say, first of all, that I'm really thankful, just really thankful for this space, because the thing that you just said, the thing that you said that you started with is, I'm suffocating. I can't breathe. And the first thing that triggers for me is the last words that we heard 16 times from a brother named Eric Garner, who was strangled with an illegal stranglehold in New York City by the NYPD officer, Daniel Pantaleo, who walks free to this day, right? The very last words Eric Garner said is, I can't breathe. That became kind of part of something that we as African-Americans connected to as a sort of a partial slogan, not just for our movement, but for our lived experience. And not just in America, in Jamaica, In Brazil, in Ghana, where there's a toxic waste dump right next to where children play football, right? And so all around the world, our shared condition as black people is a condition of suspended strangulation. Blackness is a condition of suspended strangulation. And so to even get the chance to talk about that, for you to say, I can't breathe, and then all of a sudden I feel, wow. That takes me, like, that to me is something that I appreciate. I would say that what we're doing in this space is we're engaging in something that we in the United States call Black Studies. And I understand you're getting classes here in that as part of what you're moving for is Black Studies. Black Studies being a movement to establish institutionally a process by which we can change the condition of our people. Right, where we can articulate these questions. And even if we contradict ourselves, even if we contradict each other, even if we critique each other, in fact, especially if we critique each other, we're still doing it as Black people working toward a solution to our common goals. And that, I think, is like really, really precious. And so I'm not even addressing really your question, I'm just saying, if you feel like this is a valuable thing for us to even have this space, please continue to push for Black Studies. Wherever you are, I don't give a fuck if it's called University of Cape Town Black Studies Department. Give a fuck, right? Black Studies has to be carried on wherever it is. In fact, I think one of the original things about Black Studies, and my partner, Danae, Professor Martinez, can tell you more about this because she's one of the founding departments of that. But the original purpose of Black Studies was actually included not even having a lot, I think, or even most of your classes on campus, like having most of them off campus. Having most of them where the prying eyes of the white state cannot strangle your discussion. Because when you're strangling, you'll grasp for any tool that's at hand. And you'll start trying to hit the motherfucker who's trying to strangle you, right? Because that's what we do. We're surviving pending revolution, right? We're in a constant state of strangulation. And I think if I can, you know, just kind of extend that to sort of addressing some of the other questions that we're facing. Like, brother, when you say that we need to bring these conversations together, talking about, you know, sort of an ontological, you know, revolution with a more material revolution and things like that, I think that's one of the things that Black Studies does. Having a space requires us to have these conversations. It requires that we engage with each other. That's the one requirement. It's not required that we read Hegel. It's not required that we even read Fanon, as long as we're discussing some of the ideas that are articulated out of our shared experience. Some of the same ones that Fanon came to and wrote down, but the only difference is he wrote it down. He put it on paper. There's a whole lot of stuff that goes on paper, right? But I think as long as we're having the conversations, you know, that's what's important. As long as we're staying engaged with each other as Black people, that's what's really, you know, essential. And I think two other things, if I could just real quick. I think you in the front here, you said that one of the things to watch out for. I can't deal with the question really about economic repercussions of, you know, defeating whiteness. I will say that one of the things about Afro-pessimism that I'd like to make sure everybody takes away and goes and looks more into is that it does not center on defeating white supremacy. It centers on defeating anti-blackness. White supremacy is like a flower that grows out of the pot of anti-blackness. Anti-blackness precedes white supremacy. Before there were even people called white people, our bodies were being snatched up and traded to the East, right? We were being traded from a place called Zanzibar. Zanzibar being linked to the root Zanj in Arabic, which means slaves. Still to this day in Basra, in Iraq, the south of Iraq, our people who walk around, who look like us, are referred to as out, which means slave, right? So these are examples. And then if you were in Dominican Republic right now, looking as most of us look, you'd be rounded up and deported, beaten, or even lynched because you look black. And this is by people who refer to themselves as white, but look exactly like us. Dominican Republic citizens look exactly like us because they're African descended too, right? But they're rounding up people who they accuse of being Haitian and killing them, right? And so anti-blackness is the thing that I want to make sure that we center on, which if we are articulating our movements out of the effort to confront anti-blackness rather than out of the effort to confront white supremacy, it looks quite a bit different. Right, and I can't speak to the specifics and the economic repercussions of that, but I would say that if we want to solve the problem, we have to make sure that we're getting the right diagnosis, or we're solving a problem that's not the essential problem, right? And I think that applies as well to sorry, I wrote it down. The sister who was asking, you know, what do we make of non-black positions like the colored and Indian in this society? And the thing that also talking about anti-blackness allows us to do, and thinking about it in terms of a struggle against anti-blackness, is that it's not just people who are called black people, right, who are who anti-blackness is against. It's against the blackness of people who are not even necessarily thought of as black, or who don't think of themselves as black. Like, you know, but so I think that before I get too like too heady and stuff like that, I really want to make sure that we bring that into focus, that there are you know, there are people who are as dark as me, right, who could be identified as colored, right? And I would posit that there's a different positioning of them in the world. There's a different way, in other words, the structure approaches them, right, than it approaches somebody who's much lighter skinned, right? And the perspective I have on this is more from the perspective of living in the Americas and seeing population referred to as Latino and population referred to as Arab. There are many of whom look black, many of whom are African descent. There are black Arabs, there are black Latinos, right? And so when we have a very broad group that's kind of often used as the buffer class for a anti-black structure that's enforcing its will on a black population, then I think that's something that we need to think about, that it's quote unquote messy, right? That we have to make sure that one of the things we do in confronting anti-blackness is to I think acknowledge how blackness positions people in relative ways, which is a complicated question, right? But it's something that I think relates very much to the population here that's called colored, population that's called Indian, as well as it does in the United States, the population is called Latino and Arab. Yeah.
Thank you.
But I'm grateful again for this space and this discussion, because we're performing black studies right now.
I think I'd like to start with Temba and his question relating to if we get land. In fact, land first presupposes that once we get land, we resolve our problem of blackness. So land bring us to up to par, if you like, with the human beings, which is white people. Actually, Brother Temba, no. Because if you think about the world and our place in the world as black people, the fact that I'm a Zimbabwean farmer who have my land back from a farmer who's now running to Cape Town and running some, I don't know what they run here. And I appear in the world, I have my land in Zimbabwe. I farm there. I'm safe on my farm. But when I appear in the world, I'm still a nigger. This is the big problem. Without my little farm and my little protection in Zimbabwe, in the world, I'm a nigger. If you think about the richest black people, the black capitalists even, when they're not protected by their money, they are just niggers. I mean, if you think about somebody like Oprah Winfrey, right? Mm-hmm. She herself is a billionaire. She's got money, but she finds herself discriminated against. She's discriminated against. The same with Obama, even. So, acquiring certain things, including land, is not the resolution of our problem, it's just the beginning. And here, when we fight for land, it's important that we do so, but it will not resolve our problem in the world. But it's a critically important starting point towards realizing what we must be. But it won't, because truth is that we let me and you, I want some people to go take land here, wine cake, wine lands. We must, that is, we must get our farms there, me and you. But when we travel and arrive in the US, we're gonna get shot. Not for doing anything, but just appearing there being black. So the land question and decolonization in these spaces is just the beginning of a large struggle to change the entire world, because the world is organized against us. This, I think, is an important question for me. And the issue of speaking Yoruba or Xhosa or Hausa, these are nigger languages. The fact that you have your culture, what does it mean in the world that looks at you as a slave? The fact that we have the pyramids and the original university, and we educated them when they were running naked and eating raw meat and so on. It changes nothing when they arrived here and captured us as animals and put us in the plantation, which is still where we are. Right? So our struggle starts from the beginning. So land question is very important. Black first, because we locate ourselves in the black world also, out of the African continent. But that's for me, that is where we are. We are not, the land is important, but it's not going to resolve your problems. That's why Mugabe's got problems. That is why Zimbabwe's got problems. Zimbabwe decided to take land from white people and the world responded decisively. But they make it better progress. They are at least 300 years ahead of South Africa, Zimbabwe. I believe this. Now, let's deal with the issue of contradiction. Me and that brother always fight. He came to the meeting there last year and he was very agitated when he left that meeting. Some of the things he says, I don't recall saying them, but it's fine. They are real things though. They are real things though. My brother, let me put this way. I have no fidelity, I have no commitment to structure at all, political structure, formation. I don't. I have one commitment, and that is to the revolutionary idea. That is my commitment. So if today me and you have a structure and we say we're going to make a revolution, and tomorrow that structure does not represent that, I walk. The Panthers, one of the biggest Panther problems, and Sister Asaka talks about this, was that they started defending their houses with their bodies, their offices, structures, and so on, instead of burning them down and keep on moving. So when we spoke at the UCT at the time, I was part of EFF, and I believe in the EFF project. I would like you to talk politics about what politically we said at the time, which did not make sense. Then we'll engage. On the issue of there's a big thing here where we are, again, this black face, we're back on the Sankara oath. I accept the criticism that EFF said it will go with Sankara oath. And then when we got there, after elections, the Sankara oath issue was dropped. In my book, I explained, believe me, my brother, I fought that battle internally. And this is also organizational problems. If you're an organization, you raise an issue inside the organization, right? So you say, no, guys, you must do some things. And we must try. At least, and I said, okay, not our children and partners, ourselves. Let's use the state things. The party leadership was like, we want to get us killed. And I lost the battle inside the party. The option I had was to, perhaps at the time, to say, this party is setting us out. But I was saying, we have a bigger project. We can still win this battle. We might not win it now. We might still win it later. Because also, I was very happy that a lot of members of our movement were saying, we want you to do this as leadership. And I know I was defending the party position. Right? So I take your point about, we should have implemented it, but I'm saying I was defeated inside the party. I did raise the issue, and I was defeated. And that's how parties work, right? I hope that in a movement, we will not be defeated on the reactionary positions. So we are committed to the Sankara oath. We must do it. And there are contradictions about black people. I without belaboring the point, I'm sure I said Biko was a hippie because I do believe that he was a bit of a hippie. People might not know this, but so Buga did not speak to Biko for more than 2 years after he arrived at the university and found Biko and his friend holding a real big long party. And there was drinking and there was women and there was all this kind of thing. And so Buga was very unhappy about this. But I think what I was saying about the coconuts is not a derogatory word, my brother. I have constructed this idea that the coconut is the grave digger of white supremacy. Absolutely, and I will discuss this because I think that black people who are socialized into white culture, firstly, they think they are not black. And then they come into confrontation with their blackness. And generally the coconut, this person who is being socialized into white culture like this, when they, and they won't come into confrontation with the blackness, they become better fighters against the system because they understand the system better. They have cultural capital. Listen to the roots must fall people articulating their position. This is the first generation, I think, after Biko, that articulates their position better than most. Why? These are coconuts who have come into confrontation. Of how we resolve those, including the many LGBTI here, these other, we have to find, if we build this movement, we must find a system to resolve these contradictions. And I have tried to make it to say, maybe we must look also on Mao Zedong, how he talks about contradictions. There are antagonistic contradictions between us and our enemy. And the enemy is whiteness and the people that benefit from whiteness, white people, right? That is an antagonistic contradiction. It cannot be resolved by coming together, learning together, talking together. It can only be resolved by us defeating the enemy. We fight like that, we fight the enemy. But there are contradictions amongst ourselves which are non-antagonistic. So for instance, I'm a Xhosa speaking person. I have some ideas about Zulu speaking person, this kind of thing. Those contradictions we can resolve amongst ourselves. We can educate one another. The issue of patriarchy is important. It's something that we can educate each other about. The issue of homophobia, you know, and I ask you to think about this. The only person in this struggle of votes must fall who has been forced to vacate their position is a black woman by being homophobic. We have not been able to do that with Mike Price. We have not been able to do that with any white person in position of power. So it shows you that we must be careful about how we fight amongst ourselves. If we fight with each other, as if in the same way we fight with the enemy, we're paralyzing the movement. It does not mean you must not confront me for my patriarchy, you must. But to place me in the position of the white man and the oppressor in the same way, that is the problem. Deal with the colors, must say they were enemies, the Indians are our enemies, and Botswana there, I hope you know, the Sun people and how the Botswana are treating them. We have contradictions amongst ourselves. But these contradictions are not contradictions that cannot be resolved. They can be resolved. And until we resolve how we deal with this, we're going to paralyze this movement. And I tell you what's going to happen. When you see me as the enemy, as the oppressor, you're going to go into an alliance with a white man who claim to be against patriarchy to fight me. So every time you find yourself in the same side with white people, you must know that you have moved away from the revolutionary idea. Even as you fight amongst each other, as black people, when a white person come and join me to fight this brother, you must know that I've sold out this brother. I'm no longer fighting him as my brother to solve a problem as family. These are family problems. Yes, because, you know, this happened, please. And we must have workshopped them to deal with these issues. You have put their very standard very high, your standards very high. When I look at the mission of the Rose Must Fall movement, you have set the standard very high. So don't be too hard on yourself when sometimes you don't achieve in practice all the time that you set yourself to achieve. But all the time, check yourself. Let me also say, I know, you said you don't want white people to be part of the movement, but half the time in your own committees, they've been white people, and you have not been able to kick them out. It's a contradiction. It's a contradiction we must deal with. We must not call each other sellouts because at times, it is hard to ask them to leave the room. There are times like that. But I
think that's good. This is going to be the last round. I'm sure there's some responses. Got Marcy at the back, and then we've got Buddy,
And then we've got, I'm trying to give people who haven't spoken yet to go first. And then we've got Senzo, gentleman in the blue leather. And then Clifford. Yeah, Clifford. And sorry, and the gentleman at the back.
Thanks. I just want to speak specifically to what you did to say, and I have to problematize it. Because that is awfully problematic that we have this perception of calling things within black spaces and saying these are family issues, you can't call out people. That in itself is very violent. I think we do hold ground, especially as women, especially as queer women, as LGBTI people, to call each other out, even if it's publicly. And even if we are resolving those things internally, that doesn't mean that out in the outside world, we should be able to say, well, Brian's okay because he's a man of the movement. He shouldn't do anything. We should even say, but we'll call it out internally. I think a lot of that contributes to the violence of the space. And if we're silent about it, that means that we're complacent about the bullshit that happens in these spaces. Women are, like, number one, I'm going to say, so Uber got to the party with women and there was boots and there was women and music. The fact that women, boots and music created as the state, that's a bunch of bullshit. And those are the type of things we should be able to move out. Even if Sisiko goes out in the streets and fucked up, we need to say to her, you fucked up, and in there we need to take it out and educate you internally. That doesn't mean that to the outside world we need to be accepting those type of things. These are the type of things that don't, that people, different bodies, that we need to kind of deconstruct this black liberation thing. That it doesn't mean black, male, cisgender, heterosexual. We might as well just run out of this space because we don't have a place in it. We don't have a place in it. There's a difference, maybe, just because externally or in-house we're calling people out, that doesn't mean that we're conspiring with white supremacy or with white people. And we need to make that distinction. And we're not going to stop calling men out when they're fucking up. We're not going to stop calling women out when they're fucking up and supporting patriarchy. That's something that we need to be consistent with. Both of us call them out and educate them. And we need to be clear about that.
My comment actually follows on from what my sister just said. And I want to approach your argument as being quite simplistic based on how you've looked at patriarchy as being something very isolated and not related to white supremacy itself. If you look at how, you know, people in the movement have reacted to some of the very misogynistic behavior that has happened in the space and the oppressive behavior that has happened in the space, it's because we've understood the link of patriarchy and white supremacy. And I think that it's very dangerous when you look at them as two isolated things, when the one is a structure that was implemented with white supremacy. So I just want you to please explore that relationship and not look at them as something isolated. And the way we've responded to it is in the same way we respond to white supremacy, because the two are very codependent.
Mr. Mngxitama, I do not see too problematize what you say, but I want to retrospectively assess what my ears capture. And Daniel came on and spoke about Amataba and Namakoga. You know, when you were confronted with your actions, you know, relating to your politics, relating to political structure, you say that you're not committed to political structure. But what comes into my mind is, are you committed to the basis of which the political structure was founded upon, which is your political ideology? So I just want to understand, how do you separate political structure and political ideology? And I think, you know, in the revolution, because we, the young people, are much under attack, you know, we are under attack of infiltration of people such as yourself. I think there's a growing need for people to explore teaching people about the infiltration we face. And I think you would serve, you know, a very congruent part if you explore that career. Coming back to the coconut analysis, now adopted Western norms. So you say the rose must fall has the characteristics, but you yourself again come to say that Tina's is a coconut that confronted the team. Now say you want my car. We are one of which you can do it at a book. So I'm highly confused how do I then say that I listen and capture and archive what you say? Because it does not have any time value. You understand? It is negatively discounted. You understand? I would expect for something you say today to be added on, analyzed, and to grow tomorrow. I do not expect for you to form a political structure that is the EFF and come today and lambast the EFF. What will you say about us tomorrow?
If you say no,
I mean, we haven't sold out. The EFF has sold out. So you're saying that the EFF, when it was based, it hadn't sold out? Oh, so it was founded on policies that you helped implement. So what changed now? The policies? Or did you change?
This is uncomfortable, but it's not a crisis. When crisis happens, then black lives matter. When crisis happens, we take down the Confederate flag. When crisis happens, Marikana, what happens after America? What I'm saying is, how do you create crisis? You know, and you speak about revolution, and yet we try to talk about the ideology and stuff, but we don't talk about the practicalities. Because when we speak about the French Revolution, what happened afterwards, purging, the changing of the cultural, as the gentleman said, the culture. When we're speaking about people like, why we're so close to the Chinese, we have to look at what they did, their cultural revolution, where they talked about this bourgeois assimilation of comrades and stuff. So, I mean, when we talk about the revolution, or we're just talking about it in the sense of confining the system, or really making a change. Of the way we see ourselves in the world, or maybe just changing the world. I don't know how we can, you know, this revolution talk when we're still working in the confines of the system.
I think my access of my comment and question has been captured thoroughly. But just to open it up, my question was more based on assimilation of.
Okay,
it's fine. My question is based on, you know, whenever there's a struggle, and the thing linked to the gender struggles, to the queer struggles, is always fight, united as one. And when it comes to now, let's give an example, we have the land. Then the question is, people start assimilating what used to be there before, because that's what they've been eager to. And this is lack of visioning and future thinking in what we're struggling to achieve. And whenever you get to this place, it's always here about the past, where we come from, and the horrible present we are in. But no one really ever tries to address it. Where are we heading? How are we supposed to live in the future? To an extent that even if you're fighting, even if you're doing a marathon, you need to know when to stop, at least. We're gonna keep on fighting. You better fighting yourself. And an example of that, I think I can even use the ANC leadership, ANC group of leadership, is people are fighting before we're striking. And we need to know where we're going before we start fighting, so I know what my blood is.
I think you are addressing a question about the issue of black first, left first. Masa suthole nomhlaba. And you say the statement that the fact that you have learned will not solve your problems. A nigga will always remain a nigga. I will reiterate and say, yes, a nigga will always be a nigga, no matter how much money you will have, you will always be a nigga, you will always be black in the eyes of a white man. This is why. Here you are dealing with power politics, power issues. Okay, just a little bit. You see, whenever we speak of liberation of freedom of an individual, let's not say group of an individual, a single person, we're saying, I'm able to live my life the way I want to live it. Despite what everyone in this room might say